Hello, I'm Joel Whitney, and it pleases me to welcome you to LitFilm 2021. LitFilm is Brooklyn Public Library's free film festival about writers, and it's seen remarkable enthusiasm from our audiences, largely because of the talent of folks like these two filmmakers we're about to hear from as part of our keynote conversation. If you're here, you've just watched Hemingway episode one that we've just shown as a reprise screening after featuring all three parts of the massive, brilliant film in the spring in our sneak preview. But if you've saved that film, you may know Lynn Novick and Sarah Botstein from their incredible filmography. As a short sampling, Lynn Novick has been directing and producing landmark documentary films about American life and culture, history, politics, sports, art, architecture, literature, and music for more than 30 years. Her four-part series, College Behind Bars, aired on PBS in 2019. The 80 hours of acclaimed PBS programming she has created in collaboration with Ken Burns include the Vietnam War, baseball, jazz, Frank Lloyd Wright, the war, and Prohibition. These landmark series have garnered 19 Emmy nominations. One of the most respected documentary filmmakers and storytellers in America, Novick herself has received Emmy, Peabody, and Alfred I. DuPont Columbia Awards. Sarah Botstein has been producing award-winning documentaries at Florentine Film since 1997. She recently produced The Vietnam War, co-directed by Burns and Novick, an immersive 10-part, 18-hour epic about one of the most divisive and consequential events in American history, and it aired in 2017. Along with Burns and Novick, Botstein also produced Prohibition, a three-part series about the rise, rule, and fall of the 18th Amendment, and The War, a seven-part series about the American experience of the Second World War. The War and Prohibition each received numerous awards and were among the most watched series on PBS in the past 10 years. Botstein was also an associate producer on Jazz, the critically acclaimed 10-part series. Lynn and Sarah, welcome to LitFilm. When we screened the three-part series of Hemingway in the spring, we featured Lynn's introduction to each episode. And in a way, this conversation started then. But we also featured a panel with Rose Styron, Mary Carr, Elaine Showalter, Michelle Stevenson, and Esquire's Adrian Westenfield, all women. We wanted to know at the time what was left of Hemingway that was not overshadowed by his notoriously macho persona. Your film provides key answers to this. I think, Lynn, you said it was a trip to Cuba that made you want to spotlight Hemingway maybe decades ago. But with the films coming out this year, were either of you self-conscious about his old school maleness overshadowing the project?
I think we both will weigh in on this. I don't think self-conscious is probably the right word, but I would say we were all, everybody who worked on the project, Sarah, me, Ken Burns, and our writer, Jeff Ward, and our whole producing team, our editors, acutely aware, how could you not be, of Hemingway's persona, which does sometimes get in the way of seeing him. And in, 2021, we're dealing with a completely different perspective about that persona and how we are meant to relate to people who are as hyper-masculine and sometimes extremely misogynistic as he was, not to mention many other aspects of his personality. So there's no way we could think about that. And we're actually really grateful to Mary Carr, among other people who appeared in the film and helped us kind of unpack some of that so that as women filmmakers, and just human beings, we could try to, tackle what are we to make of this man, in this moment.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was curious for everybody, and this is a very cliched answer to your question, but just the dynamics between someone's biography and their art and their influence versus their persona. And you can't avoid having those conversations with Hemingway, and having them in the time we're living in was doubly interesting. And we were very curious to hear how people responded.
Yeah. Lynn, I think you've called it macho posturing, and examining his character from childhood to death. What did you find behind it that surprised you? And I'll just add, when did you both like him the most and like him the least?
In his life?
In the parts you covered, yeah.
Yeah. It is macho posturing, and like so many things in life, you see, what is that covering up? What is he trying to hide? Because yes, it was a different time. So, but even in his time, it was extreme to be obsessed with bullfighting and killing large animals and boxing and all the things he kind of performed as this perfect, this persona, Ernest Hemingway, even in his own time, people said, this is too much. So, and people made fun of him for it, and he took great offense. And so you can't open this can of worms without thinking, okay, what's going on here? And this intense vulnerability and complicated relationship to his gender and his sexuality was very interesting and not so well known. And it's not a secret. We didn't uncover new information about that. But I think outside the scholarly community or the deeply, the people who really are deeply into Hemingway knew something about that. But for us as general audience types, it was pretty interesting to see.
And I'll answer the, when did we like him the most? I think for me, I was really curious. So much has been written about Hemingway and women and Hemingway and his wives. And Lynn just talked about all the gender stuff that is, I think, lesser known. I was often moved by trying to unpack him as a parent. And not only, there are so many photographs of him with his sons and trying to understand the dynamics of Hemingway and the camera and posing with fish and his children, but also Patrick Hemingway so generously describing the tensions and complications, but also what a wonderful father he could be and was at certain times, particularly when something happened to Patrick in his teenage years. So those Hemingway, the father, is interesting and maybe likable.
Yeah.
Some of the time.
Yeah, I didn't find him terribly likable most of the time. Yeah. And so for me, it's the Hemingway on the page that I really fall in love with more than the person. And so if I open the Farewell to Arms and start reading, I'm totally enamored with Ernest Hemingway, the person who created this or the words on that page. But the man himself, he's hard to like.
Right. Yeah. We talked a lot about that while making the film. And I think he also was totally self-taught and well-read. And that's, Lynn and I both love that.
Yeah. You talk about the Hemingway on the page and, curating this series over 4 years, we've seen a lot of filmmakers handling of writers thinking, writers typing, all of these literary cliches. Is making a film about a writer or a philosopher or somebody whose work happens up here, is it harder than other subjects?
Yeah. And we spent a lot of time talking about that because how I read A Farewell to Arms and what I see is different from how Lynn reads it. And that should be, I mean, I have a 10-year-old who has never seen a Harry Potter movie because I want her to live in the images of Harry Potter that she has conjured in her brain. And she totally loves that idea. So she doesn't want to see the movie. So I, and I will speak for myself. I love swimming in archival material to bring a historic moment to life. So to bring a piece of writing to life is tricky, but Hemingway left us with an enormous archive of his drafts and how he honed his craft and what a disciplined writer and editor he was. And so I think we had a lot of fun putting the words up on the screen. What would we look at? What would allow a person's imagination to stay engaged, but also give some meaning to the words as much as we could feel them. So that was really fun.
It was hard too, because if it doesn't match what you imagine, what we're showing, our editors were great and they did a lot of trial and error to kind of figure out how are we going to represent the work of fiction. These are not real people. This is maybe a real place, but not at a real time. And I remember vividly we did the short Happy Life of Francis McCumber. And that's a story, for those who don't know, about a couple on safari who are having a horrendous problem in their marriage. And at one point in the story, the wife actually, perhaps accidentally, perhaps on purpose, shoots her husband while she's supposed to be aiming for an animal. And in the first cut, there were photographs of a husband and people on a safari, real people, so wrong. You have to be able to imagine. We don't want to see an actual person who's not the person in the story. So we had to kind of move toward abstraction, move toward still having some way for your imagination to fill in, like Sarah's saying, and to really just cherish the words as they, give us that room and space to do that.
It sounds like there's a message here for big Hollywood filmmakers when they adapt novels. Don't be too literal. Otherwise you kill a text, right? You kill the reader's participation and the viewer's participation. It seems like that's what you're both getting at.
Yeah, and we call that like on the nose or sea dog, say dog, you know, that, or say dog.
Say dog, sea dog.
Right? Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, we're trying to be creative. We're trying to, but you know, not ruin the spell that he could cast, but also in a visual medium. So it's always a constant tension. And I'm sure there are viewers who watched some of our film and thought, that's not what I imagined. That's fine.
And also which words to highlight on screen, which words and phrases or pieces of dialogue we thought were worth extra emphasizing.
Yeah.
I was thinking as you were talking, Sarah, there was one time where one of the only times we just show the words on screen with no pictures. Yeah. And it was to show a piece of really bad writing where there was really nothing. It was from across the river into the trees.
We tried, we put a gondola in the water.
The writing was so bad and it was throne worthy. So we just had to show that and not try to take away anything from just the recognition. This is not one of his higher moments.
Got it. Well, one other way that I noticed and I thought worked really well to visualize Hemingway's mind was you showed a lot of his handwriting in the letters that he wrote. I'm sure you've done that before, but in a case like this where the machismo is such a subtext of the films, it seemed to work really well. What is it about Hemingway's handwriting that drew you to do that? I mean, it's almost like a fingerprint, right? Yeah. It's so unique. And I don't think his handwriting was particularly macho. It was very personal and intimate.
Delicate.
Very fastidious. You know, this is not a direct answer to your question, but we went around and around about whether we should try to film the actual manuscripts or just facsimiles of them, which are high res and of the original. And that's how we edited the film. And finally, just before we were done editing and really truly right before lockdown, we went to Boston and got to hold the actual documents and see the pencil and see the pen and imagine him writing. And there is something pretty incredible about that. And it does feel like a special document, and trying to bring that to life is a good challenge.
Yeah, I just wonder, when you have such a prolific figure like Hemingway, how do you divide up the reading of the archives between you? Do you do beginning to Sarah, middle to Lynn, and end to Ken, or how does it work? How do you make your way through such a...
try to digest as much of it as we can. Ken actually, he did read a fair amount of Hemingway fiction and nonfiction over the course of the project, but in most projects, like most of the work we do with him, he really likes to come to the film kind of as a viewer would, not being an expert and not necessarily having read everything and know everything, and just respond the way, you know, to help shape the story in the way that someone who doesn't know everything would respond. And I kind of take the absolute opposite, which is I want to know everything and read everything, which with Hemingway is actually impossible, because not only to read everything he wrote, but read everything about everything he wrote and every biography and every critical essay, there's no way. So we work with a panel of advisors who are experts on Hemingway and American literature and American art and history, and they helped kind of direct us. And then the challenge really became, okay, we're going to do a scene about in our time, this is his first short story collection. So which short stories are we going to highlight? So then we just get to pick our favorites, basically. And then we ask the writers that we interviewed, what's your favorite? And Edna O'Brien really wants to talk about Up in Michigan, which actually isn't in our time. It wasn't allowed to be included, but I'm not sure that would have been in the film if she hadn't wanted it to be in it. Sarah and I wanted it to be in, but it was a discussion. And when Edna said such important things about that story, that's how that ended up, you know, in the cut. So it's an ongoing process among ourselves and the people we interview and the experts who help us.
And just because we're at a library, just to also talk about how we divide up archivally, which I think is one of the most fun aspects of our work, but we have producing teams that focus just on still photographs, producing teams that focus just on moving images, and producing teams that in this case focused on his manuscripts. And we work with them and they become experts, and we spend a lot of time, but we do divide up so that people have a chance to actually really understand the archive of his life. And, you know, it's not just that he was an important writer and a really interesting, complicated, somewhat unlikable guy, but he lived a ridiculously interesting life and seemed to be actually everywhere. So just the archival material that supported and visually represented where he was, what he was doing, what he saw, what he was writing about was incredible.
Yeah.
You don't get that in every subject.
Right.
I think a lot of writers would be challenging if they, you know, a lot of writers don't live that kind of life. So
they live in Vermont in their farmhouse and they write all day.
Right.
So.
Right. You know, with that in mind, and with the, you know, you've both done much longer films. Where does this film live in terms of its difficulty? Is it among your more difficult films?
It's pretty challenging. Yeah, I think partly the questions we started with at the beginning of what's our audience going to feel about him, and technically finishing the film in COVID was really hard, and sort of representing his work in the best, you know, most complete light. It was definitely, every film seems hard because hopefully we set the bar higher each time for ourselves. So, in every way, it's hard to say. It was pretty challenging and therefore very rewarding.
Right.
I was gonna say, the other thing about Hemingway in terms of books and everything is just being in his home in Cuba and you get to see his library, because he left, you know, without knowing he wasn't coming back, and he left all his books there. And as Sarah said, he was self-taught. So the kind of scope and breadth and variety of books that he read, and if you pull them off the shelf, you'll see his markings in them. I mean, he really read most of those books that are on the shelves. It's thousands of books. So books were very important to him. Mm-hmm. And you really feel that when you're in his house.
As was music, and since we're making a movie, that made it really fun too.
Yeah.
He had a wacky and mercurial and unpredictable taste in music, which is really fun.
Yeah, all the records are there. Yeah.
Say that
all
again?
All his records are still there too.
Yeah, I guess Castro made it into a museum, is that right? So you've both worked together on quite a few films. What's it like to work with such talents as one another?
Incredible privilege. One of the challenges for us in COVID was we haven't been able to be in the same place until actually this week. We're both back in our office and we really miss each other. Really, you know, it's very collaborative what we do and we've gotten through this, but it's just a total privilege for Sarah.
We're often introduced as film married. I mean, for more than probably 20 years, I spent more time with Lynn than anyone else in my life. So those are deep roots. You learn a lot from each other. It's a fun, you get a lot of energy from the other, I would say.
Yes.
The work family kind of thing.
Yeah, work life.
And what's it like to work with Ken?
He's got more energy than anybody. He's just he's an inspiration that way, I would say. He just, everybody brings their A game and he makes that possible and does even more of that, I would say. I don't know, Lynn, you've worked with him even longer than I have.
Yeah, I mean, I came to work for Ken before the Civil War was released. So, you know, I've sort of got to have the front row seat at what happens when you create a work that's so profound and so lasting and has such an impact on so many people, and how you still keep it real, you know, and he really does. So he doesn't rest on his laurels for one second. There's enormous sort of drive to do the next thing and to keep learning and keep growing as an artist. And so that's really something to see and be part of.
That's great. So just finally, what is next for you two individually or together, and possibly you three?
Ken, Lynn, and I are doing a film about the United States and the Holocaust, looking at how this country responded before, during, and after the war, and our refugee immigration policy, and what FDR, the Congress, the world, how we understood, and the information that came to us, working on that, and a film about LBJ and his presidency. So the three of us are doing those two projects.
Wow.
Lynn is doing a big series Lynn, do you want to talk about that?
It's a history of crime and punishment in America, going back to the Puritan or colonial days up until today.
And then I'm doing the American Revolution.
Wow, this sounds
exciting. No archival material, so I mean, very little traditional archival material, so.
It's different. A different approach then. That sounds amazing. Well, on behalf of the library, thank you both for this film and for all of your previous films, which we've loved. We are excited to have you sort of add context to this amazing film that's kicked off the fall 2021 Lit Film. And it's so nice to meet you both. And thanks again for being with us.
It's really nice to meet you. We love the Brooklyn Public Library.
Yes, we do. Thank you so much for having us. We love the work you do. It's so important.
Thank you.
Thanks again.